Alright, we're back on gaming. I mean, can you really call it gaming at this point? I mean, who's really playing games? It seems like every time I... You know, at this point, I'm not surprised at what's been going on since I've been gone. Because, as you know, every time I leave, something happens, right? People lose their fucking mind. And it seems like that's... It's something that just stays consistent when I leave. So, this is going to be a very... I'll say very easy video today. So, let's start off... Well, you know, without further ado, let's start off with Kotaku. Kotaku, yeah. For those who don't know, Kotaku has been blacklisted by a number of publishers, you know, and they've come out and said this, you know, oh, I've been blacklisted and it's not fair and we're the victims, blah, 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 blah. Let's stop right there, okay? Because I want to remind a lot of people that not too long ago, I'll say a couple years ago, I'll say during my Devil May Cry phase when I was doing those videos. For those who don't remember, okay, Devil May Cry Part 5, Part 1, I spoke about publishers blacklisting journalists. Did I not? If they don't play ball. I said this. And I gave you the link to it. I showed you the screenshots of it where the journalists were talking about these things. How if they don't say certain things positive or they don't give a specific type of score, then guess what? Their games, guess what? They're going to get blacklisted. That's what publishers do. So they got to play ball. Now, when I said this, a lot of idiots back then, which I don't even think they're around anymore, but if they are, they're still fucking idiots. But idiots back then said, Vent, you're crazy. This doesn't happen, you know, in the industry. Blacklisting doesn't happen. And then we saw not too long ago, Kotaku come out and admit that this happens. So let me get this straight. I give you proof that this happens, and I'm crazy, all right? This is years ago. I'm crazy, but... If it comes from Kotaku or something, then we should, you know, then we all of a sudden should just believe them. Now, look, I will put it like this. Of course, you want to get it from straight from the horse's mouth. I understand that, okay? But when someone provides you with proof and says, hey, look at this, this is the problem, and you just ignore it, then guess what? You really are for the community. You really aren't trying to be ahead of the game. You're just trying to be a lemming, all right? A sheep. We're just going to follow this. You're just mad at Devil May Cry. No, I'm giving you facts. This is what's happening, and now we're seeing this. So, Kotaku, let me say this now. You have only yourselves to blame for your blacklisting. Not because you're being objective of certain games and things of that nature. No, no, no. That's not it at all. For those who don't know, Kotaku had leaked a lot of things when it comes to these specific companies that have blacklisted them. Now, as you know and I know, when leaks come out, that hurts developers. And I understand that Kotaku are leaking these things because... That's what journalists do at times, if you want to call them journalists. I mean, before they said they weren't journalists, they're just bloggers, right? I mean, you keep flip-flopping on whether you're a journalist or a blogger when it comes to credibility. So, if you're going to sit here and play that defense card, then that means that you have no credibility then if you're just a blogger. You're just a person with an opinion, just like myself, right? That makes you about as important as me, and I'm not really important, so that means you're not important. However, if you want to call yourself a journalist, then guess what? Then there's a standard that you need to make. You know, you need to uphold. That's why we're having this problem as of late. Now, with that being said, Kotaku, you leak things that shouldn't have been leaked that hurt developers. So when you hurt developers for your, you know, cheesy clickbait and, you know, your rampant run-of-the-mouth, you know, articles that make no fucking sense, all right? When this happens, developers and publishers, they get upset. Because you've betrayed them. And because it hampers what's going on, because they try to keep things under wraps as much as possible. Do they not? We saw this not too long ago with Ono, where he talked about Street Fighter when there was leaks are coming out. He's like, I feel betrayed, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I said, you know, hey, at this point, it's not that big of a deal because leaks happen all the time. They shouldn't happen, but hey, it's going to happen because it's the internet and you don't know on your staff who, you know me, who you can do. And sometimes, even Capcom, as we saw, they leaked it themselves. So, with that being said, you should know, Kotaku, when you don't have authorization to leak something, companies are going to get upset, and they blacklisted you. That's what happened. Now, you just have to deal with that on your own. I remember when, just a year ago, I put, you know, that list came out about, you know, sites not to, you know, to go to. Kotaku was one of them, Polygon was one of them, there was a number of them that they said you should stay away from. I remember when I posted this on the fan page, there were a number of idiots that don't even follow the fan page were chiming in and was like, how dare you decide to, you know, to not go to Kotaku? How dare you not go to Polygon? You should be ashamed of yourself. You should get a life, blah, blah, blah. You shouldn't archive. And as you know, these sites, when you see them from then to now, they have proven that they don't deserve the clicks. We have seen time and time again now how people, developers especially, are going against these type of these sites because of what they're about. So it goes to show you that our community has been on the right page. You know, of course there's going to be some idiots out there who just kiss ass just to kiss ass. And you know what? That shows you about their life because that's what they do. They just kiss ass and follow instead of just realizing, hey, look, this is what's best for the community. But with that being said, you should also understand that what we've seen this previous year, all of it is still, it's still going on. You cannot tell me, Kotaku, that you are the victim in this. You're not. Or any other site that's been blacklisted because of these things. It's one thing if you're blacklisted due to the fact that you object to what, you know, they want you to say. That's one thing because that's taking away freedom of speech, okay? That I understand, all right? Or journalistic integrity, we could say. But that's not the case here. You put out leaks, and guess what? There's consequences to that. Real-life consequences. I've been telling you time and time again, no matter how much these idiots go on Twitter, go on Facebook, try to push this moral route when it comes to, you know, social justice, and but you still make these horrible articles that make you look like a bunch of fucking hypocrites, right? And then you say, well, we can say what we want, and we don't care because gamers don't have to be, you know, they don't have to be your audience, and we can say what we want, and there will be no backlash. Now you're seeing backlash. The fact is, this is literal life. It's what it is. Companies, they gotta make money. When you leak something like that and it hurts them, guess what? They're gonna walk away from you. So guess what? You're hurting your own business because you rely on those fucking companies for your stories. Not to mention, we've seen companies, you know, give you ad revenue and things of that nature to promote stuff. So you're losing out every time when you do that. You're not taking a journalistic stand by getting blacklisted and trying to play the, you know, try to play a victim. No, that's not how it works. Because you caused this. So, you deal with the consequences. So, Kotaku, that's what you deserve. And as far as I'm concerned, you have no right to try and play the victim after all the things you have caused within, I'm not going to say just this year alone, okay? I'm going to say the previous 2-3 years, because remember, Kotaku was on board with the Devil May Cry stuff and saying new fans were mad simply because of hair, when we know that wasn't the case. BG247 was on the, you know, was on that shtick. IGN at one point was on that shtick. All these sites just tried to say, you were mad over hair with the Devil May Cry issue. And now when I bring out the truth, you're going to tell me that I'm the crazy one. And now we're seeing it all come together, aren't we? Okay, anyways, let's move on. I want to talk about Linkle. And the hypocrisy once again, since we're talking about hypocrisy, about Linkle. Now, for those who don't know, Nintendo has come out with a character, Linkle, as we know. And they're trying to say a female Link, whatever you want to call her. I don't care. I don't. Most of the community did not care that they, you know, that they decided to make Linkle, okay? As a matter of fact, a lot of community was very happy about it because they've been saying they wanted a female version of Link for a very long time. However, the backlash came from Linkle when SJWs decided to open their mouth and claim Linkle as some type of fucking victory. And for those who don't know what I'm talking about, Scumbag Steve, again. Can I even say that now because of the whole Allison Road thing? Can I still say, you know, Brianna Wu is Scumbag Steve? I don't know. It's up to you. But Scumbag Steve comes out and says that since Linkle has been made, that feminists have won. No, I'm trying to figure this out. What did you actually win? Because the last I checked, when this all started about feminism, and you just wanted to be included, didn't you? This wasn't about knocking others down to build yourself up. Oh, we've seen that already, haven't we? Yeah, we have. It just wasn't about trying to, you know, be a pissing contest or a race or trying to say one is better than the other. Oh, wait, we've seen that already, haven't we? What have you won? Because the last I checked, the community wanted this. So, if you think developers in Japan are just coming out of nowhere saying, oh my god, Brianna Wu wants a female Link, well, we better give Scumbag Steve what they want. Like, you've got to be kidding me. You haven't won anything. The fact is, the only people who win out on this one is the community. Because they've been having this demand for quite a while. And for you to try to use this as some type of benchmark, some type of milestone for feminists, is absolutely ridiculous. What have you won? See, once again, I have to keep asking, what have you done positive in this community? Every time I turn around, all I see is you trying to claim victor or trying to beg on someone else to make, you know, to make yourselves feel better. It's always about you. It's never about the actual community. Even though you keep saying, you know, hey, we just want to be involved and we don't want to censor people and black. Yeah, yeah. We've seen that, haven't we? And yet you go on and you say some shit like this. And I find it funny. Because you think that feminists have won when there's actually feminists who are saying, no, we haven't won anything. This is actually more of an insult because of the Miss Man complex. And I find this funny because Anita Sarkeesian at one point, and I'm going to show you how much she flip-flops, okay? Because I remember where she retweeted, she was telling people that you should follow Movie Bob, you know, the very same Movie Bob that said he will say and do anything for attention because he's just that much of an attention whore. He's a piece of shit. But that's not the point. The point is, she said, you should listen to Movie Bob's video on why it's good to have a female Link. And then, when you get Linkle, you turn around and say, oh, this is just a Miss Man complex again. This is not what we wanted. If you don't believe me, here it is. You know, Anita Sarkeesian, like Katy Perry said, you change your mind like a girl changes clothes. Oh, wait a minute. I guess her saying that internalizes misogyny, right? Oh, my God. Look, the fact is, Anita Sarkeesian, your fake outrage, as we know, is just for a bank statement. That's all it is. It's a money scheme. We're not fooled. And the fact that you would come out and say this after that you, you know, said something about that, saying it would be good, now all of a sudden, it's bad. And then you try to explain what you actually want. Get the fuck out of here. You gotta be kidding me. I want to make sure I get this right. I want to, you know, she says a kid sister version of Link in a non-core Zelda 3DS game is hardly what many of us meant when we said we would like to see a female Link. I want to break this down real quick, okay? Because you're saying in a non-core Zelda 3DS game, you have to understand, when introducing a new character such as a Linkle, guess what? Nintendo is going to test the waters first and put it in a non-core 3D, you know, Zelda 3DS game first. And if the character builds popularity, guess what happens? It moves up the ladder. That's what happens, okay? So for you to sit here and get mad because it's not a non-core 3DS game, ridiculous, alright? That's number one. Number two, it's hardly what many of us meant when we said we would want to see a female Link. Who's we? Who is we? You mean you? Because the last I checked, you're not the consumer. So who do you think you are? You don't buy games. You don't play games. We've seen the video where you said to yourself, you're not a gamer. And then when all this started, you started to get some momentum off of the bullshit that you've been saying. What did you do? You went out and you bought a stack of video games and you took a picture of it. And if anyone remembers, those stacks of video games, there was two of the same video game in it. It goes to show you weren't paying attention, all right? And the same video games that were in there, such as Doom, we've seen not too long ago during the E3, she got mad because there was so much hardcore violence in Doom and the violence wasn't called for. But you would know this if you played Doom before, because we know that's what one of your games were, right? But now all of a sudden you want to complain about the ultra violence. The fact is, you're full of shit. You are. And I have to keep, and you know, every time I do this, I keep asking her fans, tell me, why do you still support this? The things that she has said, like supporting segregation, why would you still support her? When you say we, Anita Sarkeesian, you don't mean the community. No, because you're not part of the community. You mean you. Or is this one of those things where your little army of idiots that blindly follow you, we? Because the last I checked, I didn't see any of those people asking for it either. Didn't see that. So, you went from saying, a female Link would be a good thing, to, oh, this is just Miss Man, this is just like Miss Pac-Man. Really? You're just going to keep flip-flopping, huh? I find that funny, I really do. But, you know, we need to move on. And I want to talk about, you know, this SJW narrative, because I do want to speak about what's been going on with Dead or Alive Extreme 3. You know, the beach volleyball, yes, you know, the game that nobody... Let's be honest here. A lot of people were not going to buy Dead or Alive Extreme 3. Alright? We know this. And I say this due to the fact that, you know, first off, my volleyballs, why are you taking them away? The fact is that these people have come out and said that they are not going to bring the game over to the West due to, you know, social justice warrior backlash because of what's been going on as of late when it comes to, you know, women, the way they're being treated. That's what was said by the company. Now, I'll put it like this. Could it be just a plan, a scheme? it's possible to just draw attention to it. I've seen a number of people who didn't plan on buying this all of a sudden saying, I'm going to import it simply for the fact that they're against this SJW narrative. So, like I said, it could be a scheme, it could be a plan, right? So, with that being said, I just have to ask people who are so, all of a sudden, so hardcore gung-ho about getting it, alright? When's the last time you bought Dead or Alive Extreme Volleyball? You know, I call it Extreme Volleyball too, because I mean, let's be honest, that's what people pay for. It's beach volleyball with women in bikinis. I mean, come on, that's what it is. And we've had these things throughout the years, and no one complained then, and they weren't really big sellers anyway. So the question should be, why does this matter all of a sudden? Unless it's trying to get hype, generate hype. Also, I'll say this. Even if this is these, if this is their actual reason on why this is happening, then there's a problem. Now, I've told you before that the industry is having a big problem right now with yielding the wackos. Because let's be honest here, they're fucking crazy. If you see the things that they say, anybody in the industry, if you were seeing the things that these people say on Twitter, you would know they're bigots. A lot of them are racists. You should know also that these people are fucking crazy. And they reach for every little thing. You know that. So for you to sit and yield to these people, to kneel to these people, it tells me the state that, you know, our community is in right now. It does. Because you've got to be kidding me that you're going to not bring this over to the West. Now remember, before this was, we don't want to take away your games. We don't want to censor your games. And we've been seeing this a lot as of late, have we not? So that should tell you something. So for all this double talk that they do, they're actually doing it. I mean, hell, when you go to the UN and you talk about how you want to censor all these people for saying that, you know, you're a liar, simply for saying you're a liar because you got the fucking proof that you cherry pick and then you exaggerate. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And this time you just flat out lie. And you can't tell me this isn't about censorship. You can't tell me this isn't about power. You can't tell me this is about taking control. This isn't about let us in so that we can be your equal. No, this is we're going to take over. And if you don't like what's being said or you even say anything remotely against it, then you're mansplaining or whatever other bullshit you want to bring up or make up to, you know, to solve your case and your defense and your narrative. That's how it works, right? The fact is, people, I have to keep reminding you, this doesn't happen in the real world. Only on the internet do people act like this. Because when you go outside the real world, guess what? You see men and women get along with no problem. No problem. None. You know what I mean? They're having fun, they're laughing, they're joking, they're walking down the street with each other, talking. Nothing. You don't see, oh, you're just a shitlord. Mm-mm. Only on the internet. It's absolutely ridiculous. Like I said, these people, you don't see them at rallies. You don't say, no, because it's all a cash scheme. If they can't get paid for this type of stuff, they're not going to speak on it. And that's how they stay relevant. You know this, but there's more. Because we should talk about censorship, all right? Because let's be honest here. Like I said, Dead or Alive Extreme, like I said, they're going to import it. Play Asia came out and said it's absolutely ridiculous that the company is yielding to SJW pressure. And what happened after that tweet went out? Check this out. Former IGN and former GameSpot journalists threatened PlayAsia for supporting Dead or Alive Extreme 3. That's right. Now they're talking about they're going to put them on the blacklist. So now we got journalists trying to blacklist sites, but yet the same journalists are complaining, you know what I mean, about being blacklisted from the publishers. Yeah. You've got to be, look, I put it like this, all right? I personally do not care about Dead or Alive Extreme 3, all right? If you want to go buy or import it, go ahead. I don't care. As far as I'm concerned, they didn't need to make this game, and they could have really focused on a new Rumble Roses. I'm just saying. But if this is the way things are going to go, it goes to show you that people are just going to come out the woodwork, and this is just every little thing that apparently is going to upset some people. This is going to be a thing for now. And for those who also know what I'm talking about, Blade and Soul. Now, remember a couple years ago, Blade and Soul. I showed you the trailer for Blade and Soul, and we've been waiting for it for a Western release. Well, now Blade and Soul is about to get a Western release. However, it is being censored to an extent because apparently one of the women's costumes or whatever is too racy, apparently, so they have to change it. That's right, because of what's going on here. So you can't tell me, and I've told you before, as much as I don't like Aneer Sarkeesian, as much as I think she's a shill, as much as I think she's a liar, as much as I think she's a horrible person, what have I said? She still has influence. And when you have this type of momentum, because like I said, who are you to make these type of demands But when you have companies who are yielding, that gives them the power. If companies said, nah, get the fuck out of here, it'd be a whole different story. I mean, let's put it in perspective. Could you imagine if us minorities got upset at Final Fantasy VII when they debuted Barrett? Could you imagine that? I'm just saying. Could you imagine us minorities getting upset when they debuted Anarchy Reigns? Should we even talk about that? I mean, seriously, you got a pimp walking around. All right, you know, like I said, there are times where you see these things, and all you can do is say, it's a game, laugh it off. Because it's a game, it's not real. Stereotypes are going to happen. And if you don't believe me, if you played any type of Grand Theft Auto, you know stereotypes happen. But the fact is, you can't get upset at every little thing because a character is wearing this, or they're showing too much cleavage, or you've got to be kidding me. This is still the world of fantasy. And people should be allowed to embellish as much as possible. Like I said, for every time you see a pair of boobs, you get upset. I haven't seen developers do anything about Ryu's chiseled chest that we just saw in Street Fighter V not too long ago, where the very same SJWs were saying, oh, that's hot. I don't see them changing that. No, muscles bulging out her neck and her arms. And seriously, every guy is like 235, 40 pounds, just chiseled walking around, cold training. Come on. Come on. But you don't see that being changed, right? No, because if us men complain, then it's, you should man up. You should have a backbone. You should be more fierce than this. Because men are, as we know, are told that we have to deal with these things. But women, strong, powerful, single women, are still trying to play this victim card. And it's bullshit. Because it's not all women. Because we see women and say, hey, there's something fucking wrong with you ladies acting like this. Yeah, like I said, they are games. And the fact that every time we turn around now, we're seeing censorship here, censorship there. But this wasn't about censorship. Okay. All right. Let's just keep moving on. Let's keep going on. Since I was just talking about fighting games, let's move on. Arc System Works. They said we will never nerf a character simply because a pro player does well with them. All right. Let's talk about this. Because for those who don't know, they're, you know, responding to pro players. Daigo, I believe, said something about it. And they're like, we'll never nerf a character because a pro player is good. Okay. And then because they can get 100% with them. I will put it like this. Fuck pro players. I say that simply because you should know. If you're going to nerf a character, it shouldn't be because of a pro player is good. It should be because the character is broken. And that majority of the community that buy your product is seeing this and saying, hey, this needs to be fixed. That's why. Anytime a character is nerfed, and we can go back to Under Night and Birth, and we can talk about Gordo before the nerf, and you know what, even with the nerf, he's still great. But you know what, if you go back and you look at Gordo, alright, Under Night and Birth, before he was nerfed, he was a monster. He wasn't even an A-tier character, he was a damn near S-tier character. And everyone who, I put this, people who wanted to win, and with little effort as possible, they could use him and get wins. And then we saw people who just weren't skilled enough to use them. And it was kind of funny to see that, you know, a person complained on Twitter. We saw this between another person and Boltstrike. They were using Gordo, but had no type of confidence using Gordo. Which, for those who don't know, Gordo in Under Night and Birth is one of the most cockiest characters in the game. But they don't have any, you know, they have no confidence using the most cockiest character, most top-tier character in the game. It's amazing. But you have to understand, when nerfs happen, it shouldn't be because pro player is good. It should be because the community is really affected by it and there needs to be fixes. We can see that. So I don't give a shit about a pro player being good. That's why I say fuck pro player. I don't care. You want to get 100% with that pro player? I don't care. It doesn't affect me any. You know what I mean? So, like I said, I'm more worried about the community at large because when you have the community at large, when you have their attention, that means then you get those fixes. That means the longevity of your game lasts, you know, it goes farther than, you know, than what you probably expected. That's what it's about. It's not about pro players and tournaments and making money. It's about keeping the product alive for so long because the fan base is there and they support it. But it seems like those days are over, right? It's all about, you know, who's top tier, who's the best player, and those are the only people who should be, you know, that should be listened to and nobody else. It's fucking stupid. It's childish, too. Let's move on. Killer Instinct is getting unique Shadow Jago character and is no longer a reskin. So you gave them Shadow Jago, it was a reskin at first, now it's a completely different character, and you expect fans to be happy? I'm just saying, like, and then a lot of people messaged me about this, was like, do people still play this? And, you know, I think people do still play this, but not many, because even, like I said, when we went to Momocon, they had Killer Instinct there for the tournaments, and it was pretty much a dead zone. No one, everyone was playing MKX in every other fighting game, and Killer Instinct was just collecting dust. So, I don't know, to be quite honest, but they need to do something about that. Also, I need to talk about arcades. That's right, because for those who don't know, Ono comes out and says that Japanese arcades aren't what they used to be. Well, no shit, because people like Capcom, you have to understand, when you have catered so much to online and you have killed arcades, and as we know, Japanese arcades, they're not just arcades, they're museums over there. We know that, okay? But we barely have any arcades here in the US, over in the, just in the West in general. Okay? And when you try to say that they're not what they used to be, you have to look at the actual companies who have made it what it is. And, for example, in this article, Ono says, Capcom is completely different with their arcades, you know, their arcade games, you know, when they have their arcades, because a lot of their arcade stuff is crane machines, and, yeah, you know what that means? That means quick dollars, quick money, you know, or I shouldn't say dollars, I should say yen, not because it's over in Japan, but the fact is, you're trying to get people for their money. If you think crane machines are going to bring people by, you know, by the dozens in and say, we're going to play this crane machine, or, as we know, pachinko machines, you are doing arcades a disservice. You're actually hurting your own business. So for you to come out and say that, you know, they're not what they used to be, well, you contributed to this. You did. People, you know, that still like, do Tekken on, they still put arcade units out, you know, and they're still flourishing. But it seems like you're all in the wrong, when it comes to Capcom, you're still in the wrong phase here. You're walking away from the community to help build you to what you are. But it's Capcom, what do you expect? That's what they do, right? They're afraid of money. But we'll keep, you know, remastering or rehashing stuff because it's the quick dollar, because fans have asked for that type of stuff. But when it comes to arcades, Capcom, you are so behind, it's ridiculous. So for when Ono comes out and says something like this, that they're not what they used to be, yeah, you helped create that. I hope you're happy. It's not what they used to be. They could be still going strong if you did things the right way. But instead, pachinko machines and crane machines. Yeah, okay. And then you wonder why arcades are dying. Yeah, okay. Anyways, like I said, I'd have been even happy if you just said skee-ball, but you didn't even do that, did you? No, you didn't. Anyways, let's move on. Speaking of Capcom, they confirm a second wave of DLC fighters for Street Fighter V. Like I said, where's the arcade stuff? Yeah, DLC, because it's digital. You just push it out to the home consoles, right? And then when people get mad because lag, and don't get me started. Don't get me started. We'll just move on. EA. Time to speak about EA and their fucking bullshit. You gotta be kidding me, EA, that this is going. EA is caught paying famous people to promote Star Wars Battlefront. Let's get something straight here, because for those who don't know, if they see on Twitter, one of the guys from, was it Breaking Benjamin, came out and was like, yeah, they actually wanted to pay me for this to promote this piece of garbage. Star Wars Battlefront is trash. That's what he said, okay? Now, with that being said, EA, what have you learned? Nothing, as usual, because you don't learn. Because the fact is, instead of trying to cater to community and give them what they want, what did you do? You went and used money to give to already famous people to say, hey, I like this game so that you can get more numbers to buy shit. Not just say, hey, look, gamers, we got something for you. We'll let the game stand on its own merit, and if it's awesome, you will buy it. But no, you can't do that, could you? Every time you've turned around, because we've seen the numbers, how much EA has spent on Star Wars Battlefront. And you know what? Like I said, we've seen this before where EA has spent more money in promoting the, you know, actual game, like Medal of Honor, they, you know, and Battlefield, they spent more money advertising the game than they did actually putting into the game. And my problem with that is, EA, you have not learned anything. You can't be, and I have to ask the community as well, why would you support this? Seriously, oh, there's more. Star Wars Battlefront single player campaign is just over 40 minutes, pre-order bonus is not ready, the game comes across as premature. You've got to be kidding me that people are going to support this. And of course, the things that I've seen, you know, developers are saying, well, my 7-year-old's going to buy it. Doesn't know anything about Star Wars, but they're going to buy it. Yeah, because you're trying to get them as young as possible into it, right? So you got them. You got them hooked. Yeah. The fact is, kids, I don't have a problem with kids playing video games in an early age. We did it. You know what I mean? But when you see all the politics, all the business that's involved, and the way they've treated the community, why would you support EA? I've seen people say, well, you know, on Twitter, well, yeah, EA's trying to pay people off, but I'm still going to buy this game anyway. I'm still going to buy the DLC, and I'm still going to buy the season pass. Why? Why would you do this? You know that they're going against, and let's be honest here, it is going against the community. Because you're paying, you're using money, because we've seen people complain about this game so much, all right? Instead of using that money to put it into the game, you're using it to pay off people. That's absolutely ridiculous. That is uncalled for. So yes, that is going against the community. Because if you make a solid product, the community will be happy and they will support you. So for all these idiots talking about how, oh, I'm going to buy the game, I'm going to buy the DLC, I'm going to buy the season pass, I don't care what anyone says, you do realize that you're screwing yourself over, right? Because they could put that money into a better quality product that you could be enjoying. But instead, you're happy with just whatever bullshit they throw at you. I swear to God, fanboys are the fucking worst. They are. Anyways, let's move on. Speaking of fanboys, backwards compatibility. Where's Nintendo's credit? I'm wondering here. Because, let's be honest here. Xbox, they said they were going to come, you know, Microsoft, they were going to come out with their, you know, their backwards compatibility. Everyone's like, yay! Even though it should have been done in the first place. We saw that. We saw how much of the backlash they took. And if those who don't remember, years ago, I said this was coming. Before the Xbox One came out, I said there's going to be a backlash with this. And it happened. And I believe not too long ago, someone actually commented in that video and was like, did you just predict the Xbox One backlash? Yeah, well, doesn't matter. But the fact is, you had fans who were mad because, as we know, they were saying, you know, well, if you want backwards compatibility, we suggest you keep your 360. Remember that? Yeah. Like I said, I'm not going to forget this shit. Not going to forget it. But the fact is, you know, then Sony, as we know, as of late, because, you know, we've seen in the previous month, Sony's like, no, we're not going to give you backwards compatibility. We're going to move forward. Remember that article? We're going to move forward. We're not worried about backwards compatibility. And now we're finding out that they're coming out with a PS2 emulator. We will talk about that in a minute. Okay? But I want to know within all this, because fans are happy. Oh, PS2, it's coming. Yeah, yeah, yeah. What about Nintendo, who's been doing this for a long time? Where's their where's their praise for this? It's all, like I said, when you have media who has jumped on Nintendo for having lack of something, and then Sony and Microsoft do the same thing, and they don't receive any backlash, it goes to show you how they're playing this. And yes, this is a media issue. It's not a publisher issue. No one paid them to say this. Or maybe they did. Maybe there's something we don't know. But as far as I've seen, this is a media issue. It just goes to show you that bias, that fanboyism. We've seen the clash between American markets and Japanese markets. We just saw not too long ago some idiot on Twitter, they posted it, it was in the comment section, but the people had posted it on Twitter, and this guy's like, I'm against all Japanese stuff or anything that's, you know, overseas like that. What do you call himself? A Westernist? What the fuck is that? A Westernist? Like, you just make up shit now. Sad. But the fact is, we have these people who have these biases, and they're just fans of blatant, you know, we've seen this. And companies have created this at one point, because we saw them play out the fanboy wars years ago. We saw this. All right? We even saw Phil Fish come out and say, you know, hey, we're burying Japanese guys. You know, Japanese developers is like, stop. You know, and we saw fans get mad at that. Like, there's no reason for this type of conflict. There's no reason for this type of drama. Unless you really have no life and you're trying to create drama. But it goes to show you that this is uncalled for. It does. Nintendo deserves their credit. Now, Sony, you're coming out with this PS2 emulation for the PS4. And we don't know what's going to happen yet. A lot of people are just so hyped, but we don't know if it's going to be emulation for physical disc. We don't know if they're just going to try and push something and give it to you like they did with the PS3 and bring it to the PlayStation Store. Like, they're keeping under wraps exactly the details of this. And I'm really hoping that it does, you know, come out to be a physical thing. Because if so, then you know what? That's just another thing in Sony, you know, another feather in Sony's cap to say, hey, you should buy a PS4. I'm okay with that. However, Sony, you still have problems. Not too long ago, what was reported, a guy was hacked. His PlayStation account was hacked. He didn't give anyone his information. There was no loophole or, you know, worm or anything. A guy's PlayStation was hacked, and they spent, $500 on his credit card? Gamers, you should know by now, not to put your credit card on these networks, all right? After what happened when Sony, you know what I mean, taunted hackers, and we saw what happened there, you should know better not to put your credit card on the PlayStation Network or whatever. Go with PlayStation cards, you know what I mean? However, back to the story. When he tells Sony that this has happened and he's got the proof and everything, Sony only gives him back half his money and not the other half. And he's waiting for his other half of his money, never comes through. He talks to billing and they're pretty much like, yeah, whatever. Nothing happens. So what happens? He goes through his bank like any consumer would do when it's a false claim. He goes through his bank to get his money back, and because of Sony's policy, what happens? They ban his account. And they decline the charges. So it means they keep his money and ban his account. This is what's happening. So this is the network that you're paying for. The service that you are paying for. That is ridiculous. But the fact is, every time something sounds positive of Sony coming out when it comes to an emulator, we have this type of news that is just disgusting. I keep telling you guys and girls, these companies, you want to ride for them? You want to back them to the moon? You want to defend them, the defense force? These companies don't care about you. They don't know who you are. You're a number to them. You're a unit sold to them, okay? So when you see them get up there in presentations and our PlayStation family, our Xbox family, and our community, if you really believe that shit, you are naive as hell, all right? You should know by now that is presentation. There's a reason it's called presentation. It's to sell you on something, all right? Seriously, Sony, I'm still waiting for you to have those digital downloads that people had from the PS3 and letting them transfer it over to the PS4, all right? Not give them 20% off to rebuy it again. When you fix that problem, then we'll talk again. Let's move on. Batman Arkham Knight. You know, is there even a point of talking about Batman Arkham Knight? We've seen how damaging the PC community, it's been to the PC community. They haven't been able to fix it. You know, but Batman Arkham Knight DLC, yes, can't fix the fucking game, but we're going to keep giving you DLC, includes Wayne Manor and Batcave map packs. Game of the Year edition is coming soon. You know this. Relax. Just wait. Okay? It is sad. And like I said, we see all the DLC they have planned. Batman vs. Superman and all this. Just wait. I'm sure, like I said, any real gamer, you know you've got a backlog. You do. I'm sure you can wait. Alright? Play those other games and when the Game of the Year edition comes out, go ahead and get it. You know what I mean? But it is just sad to see how they've treated the PC community and then they still want to hit you with DLC. Still want to hit you with the season pass. Still... Fucking ridiculous. Speaking of, you know, the PC, I won't even just say the PC community, but the community in general getting a raw deal. Payday. That's right. Payday 2 developers issue an apology for over the microtransaction deals, right? We know this is a big deal not too long ago. And here's the thing. It got so bad within that community that the moderators for the Payday, for the company, they threatened to quit because they were receiving death threats. That's right. So gamers, once again, you're going too far with the death threat thing. Just saying, alright? Scale it down a bit. There's no point. It's okay to voice that you're disappointed what's going on, and as a consumer, you're going to take your money elsewhere, which is fine, because you have the power to do that. But to send these people death threats over something that you can control, which means if you're not happy with the product, or you see the shit going on, don't buy it, don't play it, get your money back. You know this shit is going on. Do your research and know what's happening with these games before you buy it. However, even though the developers issue an apology, right, they say, all right, that no changes are coming to the microtransaction policies. So what's the point of apologizing? What's the point? I just don't understand this. And they're talking about they're going to hold, you know, this meeting with their community. They're going to have the, you know, they're going to sit in and talk with the community. What is the point? You just sat here and apologized for something that you're not fixing. You're pulling a Capcom, because remember, they did that with Final Fight, Always Online. Yeah, it was our fault. Yeah, we apologize, but we're not going to fix the matter. You're doing the same thing. It's stupid for you to apologize and then say, we're still going to keep it intact, though. What's the point? It's a half-assed apology. It's not sincere. You're not doing anything to make the situation better. Well, we'll sit down and talk to you about it. What's the point of sitting down and talking if you already said you're not going to change things? What's the point? Makes no sense. And as far as I'm concerned, you can't tell me as in the community that they're going to just be like, okay, you apologize, we're okay with it, and we'll have this sit down. What's going to get solved? You're bitching about the fact that the microtransactions, they're just sleazy because, as we know, the developer said this wouldn't be a thing in Payday 2. Then they do it anyway, right? And they got a little arrogant about it. Then the community calls them on it, and it's been nothing but backlash. Then you apologize for it, but you're not changing things. What is going to get solved? Hmm? Nothing gets solved. There's no progress. You're not changing things. You're not moving forward. You're just going to talk with people. You're going to let them voice their transgressions, and what? Then what? Nothing? Still nothing. Okay, whatever. Anyways, let's move on. For those who don't know, how much would it cost if you bought a every season pass in 2015? There's a link in the info bar. That's right. That will show you. If you bought every season pass this year, how much it'll cost. Trust me, it's going to cost you quite a bit of money if you look at the stats, if you look at the money. It goes to show you that you need to be a smart consumer, and you know, and I know, we've been talking about this for years, about nickel and diamond a consumer. You got to be smarter than this. No way. Unless you're just one of those kids where you're just spending mommy and daddy's money, expendable cash, you don't care about anything else. It's one of those things. But if you actually work and you actually have people to take care of and things of that nature, you know you have to be a lot more selective with your money and what you think is worth it and what's not. Okay? Now, I want to move on as well because Call of Duty. Gotta talk about Call of Duty. As we know, new Call of Duty just came out not too long ago, and everyone hates it. Yeah, everyone pretty much hates it. Call of Duty community, once again, you're walking in circles with this. You hate it. You talk about you want to go back to the last one, which you hated to begin with, and when you were waiting for the next one, now the next installment's here, you hate that, and you're going to go back to that. And then in a couple months, you're going to say, well, I guess the last installment wasn't too bad. Then when they come out with the next installment, you're going to say, well, the last installment wasn't that bad. I'm going to go back to that one. Anyways, Call of Duty Advanced Warfare dev says that he's stoked about the new game. That's right, because they can't wait to push it onto the kiddies. And if you don't believe me, check this out, alright? ESPN. Remember the video I showed you before where ESPN had their own Call of Duty, was it all Call of Duty room? And they were trying to plug it? Well, now they're trying to put it into your sports. That's right, it wasn't just talking about it on the actual show. Now they're plugging it in your highlights.
Our guest of honor do this one. This is DeMar DeRozan.
With the double jump like Call of Duty. And that's what he said.
That's what he said. You like it?
I love that.
That's number one.
Nope. It's not a double jump like Call of Duty. It's basketball. And he just had hang time. Stop. You're just hurting yourselves. I swear, these vultures, and I've done, anyone who doesn't watch my sports videos, understand if you're just a gamer, you don't watch sports, it's fine. But I have called these guys out time after time over the years of being vultures, of trying to take something that's popular and incorporate it into their show so that they hope that you watch it so that, you know, you go and possibly buy the product and think they're so hip enough that you can stay, you know, watching this. I always catch them doing this. As you know, I've said before, I've said it in sports videos, I will say it here. The only time I watch ESPN is for 30 for 30 documentaries and outside the lines documentary/reports. That's it. But when you bump into SportsCenter and you see some shit like this, man. It's the same ESPN at one point that said gamers, you know, weren't anything. And then now we see they're trying to, you know, air gaming, you know, in competitions and things of that nature. Now they're doing this. Yep. Mm-hmm. Gamers, you are being targeted. Understand? I mean, like I said, the video before I showed you, where they showed you actual Call of Duty room where they were sitting in the Call of Duty lounge, if that was enough to say they're trying to target gamers, here you go again. Anyways, let's move on. A developer that actually does something right. Yeah, let's talk about that. Afro Samurai 2 has been removed from stores. Game has been canceled and refunds are being issued. And you know what? I applaud them for that. Because they, you know, they realized that, you know, they were failing. And the fact that they issued refunds is what I feel is great. Because as we know, when things fall apart, publishers, they'll keep your money. Developers, they don't care. They got paid, but the publishers will keep your money, even though it failed. Should we talk about Mercenaries? Should we talk about The Last Mercenaries? How they, you know, they plugged it, they, you know, they put the commercials out there, and what happened with Mercenaries? I think about 2-3 months in, they cut the online, and then the game was pretty much useless. People were pissed off, and EA was like, still got your money. Matter of fact, how many times do you see refunds being issued out? I mean, like, consistently, you know, you haven't, have you? No, because if a game fails, hell, we even see Kickstarters when they fail. We see companies, we're still going to take your money, and we're just going to run with it. Because, you know, you're paying for an idea, not an actual product. It's amazing how many people take the money and run when something fails. This company did it right. They did. And I applaud them for that, for giving the community back refunds. I mean, I understand you're going to cancel the game, you're going to pull it from stores because you don't want people to keep buying it. You know what I mean? Hey, I give them all the credit in the world for that. I you know, appreciate that. It's one of those things where we just finished talking about a community, you know, developers of Payday, you know, and everything, saying, we apologize for this happening, but we're still going to keep, you know, the microtransaction policy going. No point of apologizing. Where these people are saying, look, we're apologizing for what happened. Let us fix this. So in the future, we don't have this problem. We're going to give you your money back. I applaud that. Let's move on. In sad news, Dark Souls 3. That's right. For those who don't know, will be the last of the series. Now, I know people are saying, oh, this is going to be a sad day. You got to think, we've had a number of games like this, and maybe this will be the uprise of Bloodborne. Maybe we'll see more Bloodborne now. You know what I mean? But they're saying Dark Souls 3 will be the end. And you got to think, for the games that we've had over the years when it comes to this style of game, you know, hey, I'm for that. You know what I mean? It's okay. At one point, you got to end it somewhere. You know what I mean? And I also feel as though, because I remember when I did a video years ago, when we talked about, was it Project Dark or whatever they called it once? And I was like, it's a Demon's Souls, you know, it's the sequel to Demon's Souls. And they're like, no, it's not! You're an idiot for saying that! You don't have any proof! And where has Demon's Souls been since? Hmm? It's the spiritual successor! It's the same fucking game. It is. And people just couldn't harness that back in the day. It was amazing to see the stupidity that came from that. They just couldn't harness it. And, you know, as far as I'm concerned, I'll put it like this. We've had Demon's Souls, we've had Dark Souls 1 through 3, well, getting ready to have 1 through 3, we had Bloodborne. I mean, I don't see where we should complain that this is ending. You know what I mean? All good things come to an end. And like I said, maybe we'll see the uprise of Bloodborne, maybe we'll see other developers we've seen it not too long ago, you know, other lesser known titles, try to take that same style. So, the genre is still going to be there for us. It always has been there, even before Dark Souls, you know what I mean? Like, or Demon's Souls, I should say. It's been there, PC-wise. So, as far as I'm concerned, this is, you know, this is nothing to be, you know, mad about. You can be sad, but it's also one of those things where it's like, I'm okay with it, you know, because you have those games anytime you want to, you can go back to, and they're still great games. They are, you know. And a lot of people are, you know, saying, yeah, you know, they're kind of upset, but they're taking it in stride. It's one of those things that you should take in stride. But let's keep going on. Gotta talk about Capcom real quick, and talked about it before, but this is more of the remaster. Here we go with more remasters, right? Resident Evil 6 is coming to the PS4 and Xbox One. Resident Evil 6! Out of all the Resident Evils, Resident Evil 6! Okay, look, we've had this discussion before. There's people who like Resident Evil 6, and there's people who absolutely detest it. And you know what? Let them make it and see what the numbers look like. You've got to be kidding me that Resident Evil 6 is coming out for the PS4. Seriously, Capcom, I'm still asking. I don't know how much the community can say this. Where's Outbreak? Bring us Outbreak with the online play again. Come on, man. Like, yeah, you really are allergic to money, aren't you? Just afraid of it, aren't you? Anyway, let's move on. Speaking of more remasters or whatever you want to call it, just bump the graphics. Beyond Two Souls and Heavy Rain are coming to the PS4. Yeah. You've got to be kidding me, right? This is a thing now. I mean, like, I'll put it like this. Actually, I should finish my Beyond Two Souls playthrough. I never finished that Let's Play. But, I feel as though the games are good. I do. I do like those games. You know, Heavy Rain for me is still, during its PS3 era, for me, in my opinion, was still top 5. And I know people were like, top 5? Yes, it was. You know what I mean? I'll put it like this. Those games of the PS3 era, Uncharted, Infamous, Heavy Rain, like, those games for me were really great. It was something different. I mean, of course we had Fahrenheit, but it was something different, and I people still ask me to keep doing a playthrough for Heavy Rain. It's because it's hilarious. Maybe I should stream it, I don't know. But, you have to be kidding me that these games are being remastered when we know that Sony cut the plug on them. This would piss me. We talked about this not too long ago. Remember, Heavy Rain was supposed to have more DLC that came along the way, story DLC that tied into it. We got the Taxi Driver one. For those who don't know, it's the Taxidermist. I call it the Taxi Driver. We got that one, and it was great DLC. That was free when you got the game. However, unless you didn't pre-order. I pre-ordered the game. But then we found out that we were supposed to have other episodes with Norman Jaden. You know, we were supposed to have, with the Origami Kill, we were supposed to have all these different episodes, and then Sony cut the plug. So let me get this straight, Sony. You're going to remaster a game that you cut the plug on. That's ridiculous. It is. Why don't you approach them and say, you know what? We need to have more of this. Why don't you? I don't get that. It's beyond me. Anyways. And good news, because, you know, we just got finished talking about going back in backlogs and emulation and things of that nature. The Sega Mega Drive makes a comeback. That's right. Sales surge by 400% in the holiday season. That's right. It's holiday run. I am happy to see this. And we also saw reports not too long ago that they're having, it's being based off of the new Sega Mega Drive stuff is being USB-abled and things of that nature. So, yeah, you'll be able to get your games. We already know that this stuff is emulated, but the fact that it's making a comeback from so long ago, we've seen this for a number of months now, a number of videos I've done. We've always seen something old school come back and make a killing, have we not? So, as far as I'm concerned, I'm for it. I am. You know what I mean? This is when games were good. You didn't have to worry about the politics. Developers and publishers were really like this with their community. They were, and they let their creativeness and they let the quality of their games stand out. It wasn't just about, I'm going to go pay a celebrity to go plug it. They didn't need to do that, because back then, celebrities didn't want nothing to do with video games. They didn't. We know that. We were a very small community. And when we didn't like something, we said, hey, this is wrong, you got to fix it, or we're not going to buy your product anymore because you're screwing us over. And developers said, you know what? You're right. And then for some reason, after the PS2 era, that all went away. Because then they try to turn it to like a PC era where they could just patch everything. So we'll just give you a glitchy, buggy mess, and then we'll just patch it later. And I felt bad for PC fans at the time, during that time, because you gotta think, PlayStation 1, things that, you couldn't patch that. Oh no, you couldn't patch those games. So you had to make sure, if those games were riddled with bugs, or they were really bad combat-wise, and for those who don't know what I'm talking about, hello, Perfect Weapon, PS1, yeah. Games that were really bad, that you played. It was like, the only way you could get any enjoyment out of it was to make fun of it. That's how bad they were. But guess what? You never went back to them. No, you didn't. You know what I mean? That's how it was. But now that you can patch things and things that, like, I don't feel bad for developers when they say, oh, you know how much it costs to patch a game? Well, maybe you should put more fucking quality into the game. I understand you have a deadline, but you need to let those publishers know, look, this is fucked up. We need to fix this. Or the community's going to be pissed off. And as we saw, I did a video, 3 months ago, or 4 months ago, where the publishers, people were saying, we knew, in the company, heads of development saying, we knew that this game was a glitchy, buggy mess, and we still put it out. And we just fixed it later. They knew it. So they weren't doing you, the consumer, I'm so sick of this. I am. I just am. Because it's not just the developers who take shortcuts. They do a disservice to you due to the fact that the community these days lets it happen. You can't sit here and defend developers and publishers, like I said, when they don't know your name, when they get caught red-handed doing something. I'm not trying to hear that you're a fan of said product. It is okay. I've said this for years. It's okay to be a fan of said product, but it's also okay to be objective. You can criticize developers. You can criticize publishers. It doesn't mean that, as they would say, y'all know I hate using this word, but you're just a hater. Come on, stop. That's an idiot taking something, exaggerating what you're saying, taking it to an extreme, and trying to label you so they can discredit you. Even though you throw a ton of fucking facts their way. That's their way of trying to deny it, to keep a blind eye to it. The fact is, gamers, you should know, when these things happen, it is time for you, and it's sad for me, because we talked about this on Twitter, it's time to stand up. And then when we talked, I had said, you know, maybe gamers won't stand up. Because as long as you have gamers falling for this bullshit, nickel and dime bullshit, as long as you have EA spending money in places that don't need to be spent and put into the actual quality product of the game that you want to pay for, come on, man. Why would you even entertain that? EA, look, we know EA, Star Wars. Going to sell because it's Star Wars. We know that, do we not? Okay, because the brand. People are going to flock to it. That's it right there. But then when you start paying celebrities to vouch for it, that's a whole different type of sleazy. You know what I mean? You don't need that. Like I said, our community, the gaming industry in general has never been about being popular to the masses. It never has been. But now since it's so big these days, everyone wants to, you know, they're trying to get everyone involved. And you don't need everyone involved. That's the thing. You don't need video game. You don't need fucking Conan O'Brien and Jimmy Fallon to debut video games. I'm not tuning into Jimmy Fallon or Conan O'Brien to see the next, you know, the Uncharted, you know, to see, you know, a leak for, you know, what they want to debut. Or Mortal Kombat X or whatever. I'm not tuning into that. No. I won't. If someone says it to me, say, hey, look at this, because I don't watch them anyway, so why would I watch them now? Because it's video game related, so they try and bring in people like me, the demographic? No. No. That's all right. I don't need that. Because eventually, like I said, those things that you see, they're going to be other places. You're going to see it. You know what I mean? At other gaming, you know, gaming sites, whether it's YouTube or, I guess, a gaming publication or something like that, you're going to see it. With the way information is spread these days, you know and I know, if you miss it on TV, you're going to see it online. Matter of fact, online usually gets it faster than TV. If you don't believe me, try watching news. Something in your house may be killing you more at 11. What? So I got to wait till 11 o'clock to see if something's killing me in my house? Like, no, I'm going to go to the internet and I'm going to find it right away. That's how it works. You have to understand that, people, stop falling for the okey-doke. Seriously. There's no reason for it. But it's sad to see that, once again, what have we learned today? You got people who all they do is stay negative, and if you don't, you know, kneel to us, we're going to call you sexist. You've got others who say, hey, we don't want to censor you, but oh wait, you're against our agenda, now we're going to blacklist you. But when gamers try and blacklist them, it's wrong. You know, there's just way too much hypocrisy, it's way too much bullshit, it's way too much drama, it's way too much insanity. It is. And you can't sit here telling, like, seriously, when's the last time you've heard these people, after seeing today what McIntosh said, tell me, when's the last time he's played a video game? Sat down, played a video game, and enjoyed it. Hmm? I'm not talking sat down, played a video game, just to tweet about the horrors of the video game. Just sat down, played a video game, and said, hey, that was actually pretty fun. You don't see that, do you? No. Because like I said, fake outrage turns into bank statements. You should know by now not to fall for that bullshit. But, like I said, I want their fans, I want them to engage me. I want them to explain to me why they feel that this type of, you know, complaining is acceptable. I want to know. It's not about being moralist, you know, just have these moralistically right about things. Because, let's be honest here, video games, when it comes to when they want to present a story, guess what? They don't always have to be right. Not everything has to be contrived. Some things can be black and white. Sometimes you can just go and save the princess. Sometimes the princess can come and save you. Because let's be honest, Princess Peach, if it wasn't for her, which is the most important character in Mario, it's not Mario, it's not Princess Zelda, most important character in Zelda, without these tentpoles, without that staple, you have nothing. Okay? You understand that? And you notice within all this, when you see these games, because we get sucked into it so much, like, oh, you're such a bad guy, you deserve to die. You notice with Princess Peach and Zelda and all them, at the end of the day, they really do show responsibility. They show that it shouldn't always be a lot of hard feelings and that this person deserves to die and things of that nature. You want to know why? Because they keep that humanity about themselves. They say, look, if we do this, we're going to end up just as bad as them. That's what makes Princess Peach and Zelda and a number of characters that are apparently tropes and stereotypes, that's what makes them great. And it seems like people can't see about an inch past their nose when it comes to that. Oh, I forgot, these are the same people who don't actually play these games. So, even though they keep getting kidnapped, they exercise forgiveness. Something we don't see a lot in games. Well, at least these days we don't. Because, you know, if someone take something of yours, or you know what, I gotta go and get onto the teeth, and we just gotta go at it. And while it's all fun and good, you know what I mean, because they're games, which they should, I mean, you pick what you want. But that's why we have these different genres. That's why we have different games. But apparently with them, you can have different games. If I want to play Doom and go off, guess what? That's my right to do that. You know what I mean? Like, that's what I want. That's what I want to do. That's my decision. But now it's super ultra-violent, blah, 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 blah. Whatever, man. Whatever. These people have done nothing. I say this due to the fact, when I say from a common sense standpoint, they've done nothing. From a crazy standpoint, yeah, they've rocked the boat a lot. And we're seeing people fall in line because they're just scared of the crazy. They are. They're scared of it. But you've got to be kidding me, people, that this is just something that is going to affect our community. This is something I said. It's not just, and this isn't a Gamergate issue. It's not. This is about a community issue where it's affecting us now and what we buy. And if it's not corrected, you know, there's going to be hell to pay and blah, blah. We've dealt with this for so long. I mean, how many media, how many advocacy groups, how many people do we have to go through to finally say, okay, we're going to leave gamers alone? Because, you know, you didn't like us to begin with. You know, back in the day, we were just, you know, standoffish and we didn't fit the status quo, so we formed our own community. Now you're back saying that we're still horrible people and whatever, man. Nothing changes. They repeat history, and it seems like the people who react to this type of stuff, they fall into it. It's like you understand it. You're taking the bait. It's okay to expose people, and we've seen that time and time again. It's okay to expose them, all right? But to go to a point where if something you like isn't there, you're going to go to an extreme where we're going to, you know, send death threats. That's fucking ridiculous, you know? But it goes to show you, after the things you've seen today, these people who are on their moral high horse, they're no different than those that they judge. Don't blacklist us, but we'll blacklist you. No different. We're talking about, you know, that we're being harassed. Okay, so where's the harassment? Right here, this person called me a liar. That's harassment. What? Come on, man. Anyways, I hope y'all have a good Thanksgiving. Or, you know, for those who celebrate Thanksgiving, you know, and those, I know this Thanksgiving has passed for some people and had belated Thanksgiving. And that's another thing. Be happy for what you got. Family, friends, reality. Because if you see the way these people act online, I'll say it, they got no fucking life. None. Have you seen the complaints? Man, just complaining. Captain America and Iron Man, it's a superhero movie and they're going to punch their way out of it. And don't you get tired of seeing it? They're fucking superheroes. It's an action flick. What do you expect to happen? Them sit around for 2 hours and talk? Get the fuck out of here. Like, come on. Like, no lives. They just don't know how to have, they just don't know how to let it go and just enjoy something for what it is. I can play Miss Pac-Man right now and have fun. And then I'm going to have someone else saying, oh, that's Miss Man. That's how you see things. If that's the first thing you go to, instead of saying, hey, this looks fun. The problem isn't with the video game. The problem is with you. But they don't want to hear that, though. All right, people. Anyways, I'm done. I hope y'all have a good week. Hope you have good holidays. We'll start back up next week. I'll talk to y'all then. Y'all be safe. I'm out.